You just send your file. Let's see. Pick something up. All right. So let's see. You graduated from the school in Egypt, and then yeah, he has a PhD in Cornell, right? Around 1980s. Right? 89, you started this, I believe. So he's our main star in hydrology and geohydrology studies, and particularly with respect to modeling. So today's topic is groundwater modeling. And the readings we had just gave you something simple from USGS as the assigned assignment, and there's a couple of papers on there supplemental. So you can look over those. And then I'll get the stuff for next week. Bob Whittier will be speaking. Seminar room will start at 3 o'clock because it's a WRC seminar joined with us. So it'll be in there next week at 3.
And we have the readings available?
I'll get Bob's up this afternoon. He sent me one already. We're picking like a chapter out of the book. I don't know, we've been arguing about what you should read. He had this child thing, I said it was too much. So I'll send you a notice of it too. Okay? Without further ado.
Could we turn the lights?
Yeah, I can
do it.
Thank you.
Hello, everyone. Actually, I wasn't sure about the background of everyone. We'll start from the very beginning of the subject. So basically, the outline is this. We'll talk very quickly about groundwater processes and what we are simulating. Then I will talk about how the model is set up and what's involved in the modeling process. Then I will give a couple of examples, one in Oahu here and one in Jeju Island in Korea. The objective to show how we choose the model, how we set the conceptual model, and what is basically a requirement to satisfy our objectives if we choose one model or the other. Then, once they get tired, 2 years ahead, we'll talk about modeling submarine groundwater discharge charge. And basically, that will sum up what we can do to deal with that. Then, at the end, we'll show some demonstrations how we set up the model and how it can be used. So here's the first one. We all seen this one before, right? We are interested more in the groundwater part. And I don't know if you can see this from the back. You won't need to see all the written stuff. At least you can see the colors. So there is red color, there is blue, and there is green. So you can see here how groundwater and aquifers are connected to surface water bodies and what kind of variability or stratifications it could have, different type of aquifer. We call this one unconfined aquifer here. And basically the recharge from the surface, groundwater surface, which is that one. And the black line here is the water table. And basically you can see wells that can go to this part of the unconfined system. And this is directly connected to the stream here. So the blue shows water and direction. So the arrow is the direction of flow. So then we have to include the interaction with stream flows or streams from the river, obviously, because they are connected to each other. But you could have deeper groundwater formation, deeper aquifers, which are not connected directly to recharge. So they would be a little bit safer from contamination by surface sources. So deeper well should be more safe than surface shallow surface. And then we can see variability, which is basically rocks and sediments, things like that. Even with this information, we have to suffer characterizing this kind of variability when we do the modeling. That's basically one of the most difficult part in the process. So that blue color or water flow I mentioned, the red are potential sources of contamination. You can go through around these. By the way, I will provide a copy of the slides. And if you want to get a printed copy of this, I can give it to you. So, for example, crop dusting, you know, that source of pesticides, things like the deep injection wells could be another one. Septic systems, discharges from the fertilizers around the house. So basically, that anything on the surface that can end up in the aquifers would be a source. The green things reflect what actions are taken by the government or by us to stop contamination, like conservation areas, like basically here, source water protection area, for example, like design areas around them for protection, local land use decisions, protected wetlands, things like that which are used by the government to do that. Why am I showing all of that? Because basically that's what, in principle, what you could be modeling. So there's physical processes involved, like water flow, like contaminants. We need to include this in the model. There is land use decisions that need to be implemented. There is climate which affects all of that. So you need to integrate all of that in your model. So how is modeling this done? I need to write equations describing all the flow and transport processes and solve them. Okay? Then do some assessments or scenarios and things like that to make decisions. Like, for example, if we want to do this one, actually, this is the example I will be showing. So I need to run the groundwater model and estimate directions and velocities and set up protection areas around the one. Then that will go to the decision makers to protect the area and align whatever regulations within these areas. Another important point is you cannot really recruit everything that you can see here, obviously, right? So you need to make a decision, like what kind of processes I'm interested in. Am I close, too close to the ocean? I need to increase salinity. No, I'm far enough, I can ignore that. Do I need to worry about temperature variations? Do I need to worry about the unsaturated zone? Like here, this is called the unsaturated zone here. And for example, some models ignore that, like the one we're using today, and assume everything on the surface will just go to the saturated zone. But for agricultural practices, this is not acceptable, because most of the agricultural things are in the unsaturated zone, and this is like a first layer of protection. So that could be important to simulate that. But sometimes you need to make a decision, because if you include the unsaturated zone, the equations will be too complicated, will be nonlinear and require, you know, restrictions on size and take too much time and effort to run. So you need to make a critical decision, should I include that or not? Then all these sources of chemicals can contribute to contamination, and we need to make a decision what are the contaminants of concern, like nutrients, like salinity from near the ocean, etc., like hydrocarbons, for example, oil, diesels. So that you have to decide which one you are interested in. And the best would be an integrated approach. That we include everything here. So it would be nice to include surface water interaction with the aquifer. It would be nice to include, you know, like all different sources contributing to contamination, and that will add up to complications. But integrated approach is a preferred. Okay, very quickly, groundwater is very important. About 1/3. Average for the US, like 40% for public water supply, 33% for irrigation, 17% for industry. In Hawaii, most or almost all of our water for public water use comes from groundwater, and half of it for other uses, or half of other uses come from the ground. This is irrigation, this is water supply, and industry. Do you know this picture, what's the back?
Is the last of the fungal water, Mr. Moodle, is the water.
Right. So that's basically expert carrying this wishbone kind of a stick.
That's Russell Crowe, right?
What?
That's Russell Crowe. There's a recent film that came out with Russell Crowe.
I see. No, this is a whole thing. So anyway, so like Joe said, so this man will move with the stick right from groundwater. And once they start moving like this, he says dig here. Okay? Then they dig. And most of the time they found water. Why? Because there's water everywhere, right? There's ground water everywhere. It's just a trouble. It could be very deep and very expensive to see. But there's groundwater everywhere. And actually, I watched it 60 minutes long time ago, and everybody was nervous while digging. This guy was sitting whistling and enjoying his time, and suddenly the water started gushing. You know, they hit deep artesian well, and water started gushing, and everybody was excited carrying him and chanting. So, so the trouble is how deep the water is. Okay, so there's groundwater. And if you look at components of the hydrologic cycle, most of the water is salt, like 97%+ is salt water. The 2%+ is fresh, and most of that is groundwater, actually. So surface water, surface like fresh water, is very small amount of useful So it is a good source, but unfortunately in the past people didn't realize that things they do on the surface will end up there, so we have lots of water quality issues to start with. So this is just very quickly what types of aquifers that we might have. We have a confined aquifer here, and unconfined aquifer there, and separated by what we call the confining layer, which could be like zero conductivity, means no flow area here. So that this way they are not connected, or could be what we call aqueduct, which allow water to go in between. So you could dig a well and use water from this one or deeper one to get water from here. And if they are not connected, then there's no basically interaction. So whatever you do here will not be affected by that and vice versa. This one, as I mentioned, can be contaminated from surface sources. This one can be contaminated for protected. But there must be a source of water that comes in here, so this picture is not very accurate. So we have here the water table, which separates the water body from the surface unsaturated zone here. So the whole water table is just like. But if you dig over here, water would rise above the confining layer, so you could have another surface which reflects the hydraulic head or water pressure in this layer. So you could have two lines or two surfaces, one for the unconfined aquifer and one for the confined aquifer. And depending on the relative locations, potential water movement could be up or down, depending on which one has higher elevation. This is the same almost setup here. We have a confined aquifer that we charge it from the mountain here. And we have an unconfined system or aquifer here. And in addition, there is a pressure aquifer, which has a low conductivity area here, and water can accumulate at the top here. So how many water surfaces we have?
Three now,
right? We have the dotted line here, which reflects the water table in the unconfined aquifer. Okay, so this is a true level here, above it unsaturated, okay, and saturated here, so the water is up to here. And this one has, if you dig over here, it will rise to this level, and that because it is above the surface, it will be free flowing artesian well. So this is like a spring, so you no need to pump, so water will be gushing out of this one. And we have another water table above that pressure aquifer.
So that could be sea surfaces, and it could be interaction between these, and maybe overflow here that can also get to the unconfined. And something interesting, maybe you can elaborate, that it's important, like if here is the ocean, would like to identify the resource tracking and do connectivity between different aquifers so we can find out if different systems are connected. So geochemistry can help in that fact.
Sure.
You want to summarize your dissertation? Okay.
We can have
another months.
Another class. Okay, if we look at our local picture here, it is kind of different. So we are an island next to the ocean. So we have, this is the ocean here. This whole section is like on Oahu, or it's windward side to leeward side. So we have different systems. We have the freshwater lens here, basalt water in this area here. And we have high elevated water here because of the dike system, so the water elevation is high here. Then we have what we call the capra, which is marine and sediments, marines, deposits, and sediments. And this is act as a confining layer. Okay. Then because we are sitting in the ocean, there is salt water here, and there is brackish water in between because of the mixing between the fresh and salt water. And we could have pressured water over in some areas here. So basically we have the three systems here. We have unconfined aquifer here, and we have confined aquifer here. And the boundary is like H1. This is a highway here on university. Basically from this point to the ocean is confined by the capra and unconfined about that. So actually the capra is very useful. Why? Because it stops contamination from any sources here going down, because water moves from here to up or towards the capra. And at the same time, it's retarded because of the cap, but less water will run to the ocean. So if they build the marinas, that's bad, right? Because they destroy the capra, so you lose basically the confining action, and chemicals can go to the hazard. So to develop the water, we have deep wells that go down to the freshwater vents. And if you dig wells in the salt water here, and at the same point you dig a well in the capra, then the water level or height will be higher here, so water is moving upward here to the capra. Then we have the high elevated water here, we talk about maybe 75 meters above or higher than the Schofield. In the mountains could be higher than that. Then the water level in the basalt is about 6 meters at the highest elevation. So there is a drop of water here at what we call the Schofield Dam, which is the separation between the high elevated area and the basalt. So to build a model for a whole island, we have to consider all these features. And this is what I will show later. Of course, questions anytime, right?
Yeah, anytime, please.
Okay, now to do the modeling, we have to write equations and solve them. That's basically the idea behind models. So mathematical formulation has to consider the fact that we have some kind of material that's not like wind material. It is some kind of system that includes solids and voids. This is if you have basalt rocks. The fractures where water is stored and moves. But you could have non-consolidated material which include grains and voids. Okay? So water moves obviously in the cracks. There could be some situation where water can move also in the rock. So we consider this as the main porosity and this is as the secondary porosity. But in our applications here, we ignore that, assume only that you have water that goes through the fractures. To write equations, we have to assume what we call porous material assumption. Porous material assumption means that if you take the volume of the rock or the soil, the aquifer material, it will be considered as representative of the whole system. So basically, I take a chunk like this for rock, include enough solids and enough cracks or enough voids and grains that is representative of the whole system. And I was explaining this yesterday in another class. So I should have enough size like this that include rocks and fracture such that if this is porosity versus the size, so it should be something like this. So this is the appropriate size. Okay, so porosity basically okay, so this is how porosity is estimated. So I should have a large enough volume such that whatever at that size, porosity will not change. But if you use a small size here, then porosity will depend if you're hitting rocks or voids. Okay? Like if it is a whole solid rock, then porosity is zero. Right? So this thing can fluctuate maybe zero here if you hit voids. But if you hit voids, then it will be 100%, right? Because there is no rocks, it's all voids. So once it reaches the constant value here, this is my control volume, which is what I need to write the equation at. So it is large enough to give you representation of the system, but small enough to still consider as a point, mathematically point, right? Like when we measure the water level, we stick it there and it give us the height of the water at that point. Okay, so this is considered a point, right? But it is large enough to represent the system and the equation would be valid at that specific point. So that makes it challenging actually, because can we include lava tube in this representation?
Not cheaply.
But we cannot include it in this method, you know, this formulation, because the lava tube is large and it doesn't, this is not considered as a porous material.
Can you use an average if you knew the approximate void space of your lava tubes and average that throughout the rest of the material?
You can, but it cannot, but sometimes it's not very accurate, especially if you deal with contamination, because this would be like a tube, larger tube, and the chemical can move very fast and this might ignore your small scale cracks or fractions. So there is one way you mentioned, which is average. Out, sometimes does not work. There is other way which you deal with it as two systems. One equation for the tube and equation to describe the porous material and there is interaction. So water can be interacted and can interact between the tube and this, like water goes back and forth. Which makes it very difficult. Any idea why? Because you need to know the location of the tube. Diameter, friction, everything. If you talk about one tube, maybe, but if you talk about large, maybe number of fractures, large fractures, 16. And one third method, which include the statistical distribution. I could have my system divided into groups with known size. And here is one system, two systems, three systems, and each one is treated as a post. And they treated in some averaging, but in statistical sense. But again, that will still average out the peaks and, you know, concentrations, because you are averaging as a mean. So if you average behavior rather than peaks, then you deal with variation of contaminations. So this is the picture we'll try to model. What you can see here is the water table is here. And the area below it is saturated, fully saturated. And above it is unsaturated. So as I mentioned, the model we deal with today, we'll assume you have saturated only here and completely dry above it. Completely dry. Sometimes if you want to answer it, it's not really accepted. If you talk about Central Ohio here, if you go to Conea, the water table is like about 1,000 feet below the surface. This is huge, right? So you cannot really assume that rainfall will jump quickly and reach the water table. If you have contaminant, it will take many years to get from that level. So it's very important really to study the unsaturated zones. But the price is expensive to do. Okay, so we need to write equations. So this is my modeling system. I call it modeling domain. So I need to write equations describing different things I'm interested in. And I could be interesting in the water table or water level in the aquifer, or the chemical concentration, or temperature, or whatever. So this basically I would like to simulate. And you could have multiple species, like nutrients, different nutrients. So each one will have a separate equation. But if you have chemical reactions, you have to include this also in that concentration equation. And the equation should describe the processes over the space and the time. So you could have one equation for each and stop there, or use whatever you solve to estimate velocities and study concentrations and temperature. And the objective is to find these values at different times and space. So it has to be a partial differential equation, because the head changes with the space and time, okay, so more than one independent variable, and the same for all of these. So I could really have a very complicated situation. Like what? Let us say we deal with petroleum product near the ocean. Okay, so you have to consider density of the product, you have to consider dissolved phases, you have to consider nutrients. You have to consider bacterial activity and, you know, tides, things like that. So it will be really very complicated to include everything, but you need to make a decision. And even if you talk about gasoline, the gasoline itself is called heterogeneous liquid, because it has many constituents, like 200 constituents, and each one has different characteristics, so you can really get lost in dealing with it. So the first decision is to decide what equations you're going to solve, and of course within that area or domain, you have to know the boundary or set the boundaries where your study will be done. And here's an example of the saturated flow equation. And this is similar to what we've been solving for our demonstrations today. So this is basically three-dimensional equation describing the hydraulic head or water level. which changes at different locations, X, Y, and Z, at different times. And this basically aquifer parameters, which conductivity is here in different directions, X direction, Y, and Z. And this is a storage parameter, basically. This equation is very simple to describe. Basically, what it tells you is, by the way, this is conductivity multiplied by the gradient give you flux. Okay? So this is flux of water in X direction. And this is flux of water in Y direction. Flux of water in Z direction. Then this is any direct injection or removal. Okay? So, and this basically changes time. Then when you take the derivative of Z, that means in minus out. So in minus out in X, in minus out in Y, in minus out in Z. And this is direct addition. Because of all this ins and outs, the head will change your stuff. The total level will change your stuff. Okay? And I always say this is like your bank account, right? Ins minus outs will give you the change of balance at the end of the path. And basically, the storage has to do with compressibility of the aquifer material and water. The material itself, rocks itself, is not compressible. We talk about the space, the voids. So the material will compress to force water. But sometimes if compressibility is too large, like if you pump too much, then the aquifer will collapse. Like you get land subsidence or sinkholes because of too much pump. So to solve this equation, we want to find H. So you need to provide the conductivities, and you need to provide the storage coefficient and the FEF wells injection or pumping. So you need to know all of that to solve this equation. So our final objective is to find the H, water table or water level, at any location X, Y, and Z, and at different times. This equation is three-dimensional. Okay, but sometimes that will be too much for me, so I'd like to solve it for 2D because I consider nothing changing in the Z direction, like D by DZ equals zero or small, so I can cancel this and deal with it as a two-dimensional. Like if you have shallow aquifer, then nothing changing much in the vertical, so you can deal with it as two-dimensional in X and Y. Or the cross-section, like say, from the mountain to the ocean. I can just take a strip and treat it as a vertical cross section. Actually, mud flow, do it in quasi 3D, which is basically you divide the aquifer into layers, and each layer is treated as 2D, X and Y. But they interact, the layers interact vertically. So it is quasi 3D, takes less time and therefore to solve. But we say 3D because that's basically, if you use enough layers, then it will be like 3D.
So you just use that term mod flow?
Yeah.
For the first time, so people probably don't know.
Okay, good point. It's coming. But for now, this is just a software to solve this. Not good enough. You can close your eyes now. That equation, as I mentioned, talk about saturated flow with no density changes. So it doesn't work if you are interested in island hydrology close to the ocean, right? If you are interested in SGD, then you need to solve for density-dependent equation. It looks similar to the one before in a way. Basically, this is a change of head with time. This is fluxes in and out, but you see density in the equation, okay? You see density in the equation, which is important because you have flow because of density change, regardless of the change in pressure, so you still have flow even without the driving force beyond the density. So we need to solve this equation in this case. Not only that equation, but you need to solve an equation describing solute or density, or basically salt concentration. And that's the equation for chemical transport, but basically include density also changes. So you can see all kind of fluxes, all kind of reactions as well. And basically our objective is to solve the two equations simultaneously. Okay? Because as water flow, the hydraulic head will change, density will change, viscosity can change, and you have to iterate within that system to find the flow as well as concentration of sodium chloride. Okay? So because you have density, you have solute, then it has to be combined with the water flow. So to do this concentrations here, we have to have all the fluxes. Like basically, I need to have H in this equation here, H is here. So basically, you cannot solve this equation without solving the previous one. But the trouble here is that the equation is linked, as I mentioned, because as the head changes, density is changing, so all the coefficients will change, so you need to iterate. But if you do like conservative chemicals, okay, or chemicals that are not affected by density or by water flow, you can do it separately. You do the water flow first, then solve for the chemical task. But there is something essential that we have to have, which are the boundary conditions. To solve the equations I showed to you, we need to specify the boundary and specify the condition there. Since this was my domain, I need to know where the boundary are located. For example, if you are dealing with the whole island, then the coastline is the boundary. Okay? But if I have the Pearl Harbor aquifer, I have internal boundaries that I need to specify the location and the condition there. Once you know the physical boundaries, then you need to set the condition there. And we have three types of boundary conditions. The first type, which is specified head or water level. That means I need to know the water level or head at all times, at any location. So this part of the boundary, I need to know the head. And this would be like, for example, the ocean, the coastline. And I could set the head here equal to the zero, which is mean sea level. Or I could have tides. So this could be changing with time, but still I have to know it. It has to be known in advance. The second type here is this portion of the boundary. It's called the second type, which is specified flux. So I need to know the flux between this aquifer and the boundary of the area here. This could be, for example, if you have the Schofield here, and this is Pearl Harbor. So there's water which leaks from this aquifer to there. So again, I need to know the amount, which could be constant or changing this time, but it has to be known. So the last one is called the third type, which is head-dependent flux. So the flux depending on the head difference between this aquifer and the neighbor. So basically the gradient here will control how much water goes down. And the gradient could be changing, which makes this one change. So this one I don't know in advance because I don't know the solution. So it has to be done by trial and error, so it will iterate until it finds the appropriate flux. So you need this basically to solve the equations. There is no way you can solve the equations without boundary conditions. But sometimes it's not easy, right? Because there's no physical boundaries. I cannot deal with my aquifer, and I don't know even the condition there. Like there's some areas, you see there's high elevated wells very close to low elevated wells, even more everywhere is a separation between the two. So sometimes it could be very difficult. And you have to do field work or geochemical work to find out the exact connection. Now we have the equations, would like to solve them very quickly. You need to formulate a conceptual model for the area, right? My favorite word, conceptual model. But sometimes we call it just model. This basically I decide in the area and I try to describe it physically and chemically and biologically. What is exactly happening? What kind of processes are there? And we call it non-unique representation of reality because different people can have different conceptualization of the area. Say, tell me, it's two-dimensional, I tell you, no way. You know, I want to consider unsaturated zone, you say, no, it's not important. Actually, the aquifer certification is this and that. So everybody can have different conceptualization, and that makes really non-unique. And that's basically, there is a court case, this is always the argument. You know, your understanding about this is wrong. Basically, that's the basic argument that lawyers or expert witnesses use. Like Mahaina, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Why didn't we get the tracer in the ocean? Do we have unique explanation for that?
Depending on my uncertainties.
Right. So basically, it has to do with the understanding of physical and geological formation, physical processes. So this could be different representation of reality. Then here is your question, right? Like the software which solves the equation I showed you. So this is a computer program that's representing a model numerically. And I mentioned the mud flow as an example. So this model solves the first equation I showed you. Then this is the second model which solves the density dependent equation. Then you could have a package like the one I will show you today. It's called the groundwater modeling system, which includes all these models and more, plus data manipulations and results representation.
I think it'd be useful to explain to each to us all what each model is good for, how you use it, and how they relate to each other.
Right. I think it will come, but
okay.
Maybe I can mention some.
Yeah.
So as I mentioned, mud flow solves that equation I showed, which gives you a solution for H at X, Y, Z.
Mm-hmm.
So, but you have to provide boundaries and parameters to do it.
Mm-hmm.
So that one is for no density, it's just water flow. That node density changes. And this one includes basically mud flow, but includes also another software, which is called the MD3D, which deals with the concentration. So remember the two equations I showed, which has density, the water flow and the chemical transport, which density is changing. Density changing. Is that good enough for now?
Depends on what you want to get into, but I think, you know, since we're studying submarine groundwater discharge,
right,
maybe you want to put it in terms of specific applications that people might.
Yeah, well, I will show it something. So ZGMS is a nice interface. It's just I can enter my data and run and look at the results. Okay? But this is a software which solves the equation that we are interested in. Then because I cannot find easy solution for complicated problems, we have to solve these equations using numerical solutions. And basically mud flow and see what is called the numerical models, because they solve the equations numerically. And then any model or site model will include the conceptual model, the solution using any of these, and the data that you need to run to that.
I think it will become clear also when I show the demonstration.
So to do it numerically, I will have to divide the domain into small elements or cells, and solution is obtained at the node or the center of the cells. Okay? So basically, I have the domain, three-dimensional domain. I will cut it into cells, small cells. This is requirement for the numerical solution. Okay? And define the solution at each center of each of the cells. Again, I will show example. Then, with the solution requires solving a large number of simultaneous equations equals the number of nodes. So if you cut the aquifer into 1,000 cells, then at the end you have 1,000 equations to solve, describing the solution for each of the cells. Obviously, you cannot do it by hand, right? And that's why we need the numerical solution in the computer to do that. Then once you get a solution, you need to do something called the verification, followed by calibration and validation. Verification is to make sure the results are reasonable and accurate numerically. Like basically, you know, 2 + 2 = 4, but if you do a numerical solution for that, it will be 3.95, okay? Why? Because there is some approximation. So you want to see if the model works accurately for simple cases or for some cases which has obvious solution, to make sure that the model is numerically accurate. It is like, I give the example, if you have a thermometer, which is, you know, it works to give you accurate results, right? So you test it and verify it and maybe calibrate it as well to give you the accurate results. Calibration, speaking of calibration, it is a process. You run the model many times until it gives you what is expected based on field data. So you collected the field data, Chris collected all the data from American Samoa, then comes back to the office and calibrates the model to give you what we expected, right? Some people consider this as kind of a cheating, right? Because you are forcing the model to give you what you want. How do you force it? By changing the input conductivities and the storage coefficient, etc., until it gives you the answer you want. But there's also, we put constraints, like hydroconductivity should be within that range. Porosity should be within that range. So you do the tweaking, but within constraint to make sure it gives you the result. But sometimes the model, or most of the time, or all the time, the model is not unique. Why? Because I could do the same effects by changing two different things. Like if I want to change conductivity, I could change porosity to give me the same effect. Okay, so the model is not exactly. The last step is to do validation, which is the same as calibration, but I don't change the parameters. Just run the model with the last data, with the last input data you got here, without any adjustment to get another set of results. Like if you have 20 years of records, I use the first 10 for calibration, then whatever I get from that, applied for the second 10 without any adjustment, and you see if it is accurate. And I don't know why I remember, are we there yet? That's basically the calibration process. It's a very tedious process. You have to do it many times over and over again. But fortunately, they have automatic ways to do that. Okay? How it's done? By the computer, not you, right? Because the way you do it, you change things until you get accurate results. So basically, let the computer do it.
So give him the starting numbers and range, and let the computer try it until it gets you the best match. But sometimes it doesn't work easily, so you have to do it manually as well as automatically. So you get the computer the best start, then the computer will give you a reasonable answer. So calibration is tedious, takes too much time, and sometimes it doesn't even give you reasonable results. And also, it's not really, again, unique even for the same setup. Like say you calibrate the model for a steady state case, okay, to get compactable. Then try to run it for transient, it doesn't give you good answers. So it's even for the same aquifer, it doesn't give you the exact data for given enough time and resources, anyone can be a genius. Maybe not. I don't know, I could even do better than that, right? Okay, so why we use models? The first objective is to understand processes and systems, and this is how science is advanced. Because the model is not working, then I try to improve in it and add process different things that will make it work. And you can look at the history of modeling. You see it's hand by hand with advances in science. Then you can use it for data collection. Like you build a model, but it is not working, you need your data so you can design and find out the worth of that. Is it conductivity I need, or porosity, or dispersion parameters that give you the better results? Then the most widely used is future predictions. Like you need to make decisions, you know, like say, I want to do this, any of these things, so I need to model to help me. And you cannot really go to the field work without guidance. Like say, digging one well could cost $500,000. You don't wanna, you know, take a risk and do that, right? You need some guidelines. So you do the calculations on your computers and do the field work.
Unless you have a stick.
And this one is really most of the things this would be very useful for modeling. Like you want to optimize your resources. Should we use it for agriculture? Should we use it for golf courses? For residential area? So you can use the model to help the decisions. This one, if you want to clean up an aquifer, should we use physical methods? How many wells we should use? Where to dig it exactly? So, as I mentioned before, we decide on a conceptual model, then we choose the appropriate model, then verify it, calibrate it, validate it, and start applying it. So here is a conceptual model. That's basically all the information that I can have about the site, then the boundaries, and the initial condition. Oh, I forgot to mention the initial condition. Initial condition is the start of the system at time zero, like my initial condition of the aquifer. It doesn't have to be at, you know, year zero. I mean, 1955 is my time zero. So that would be my initial condition, like flat water table or contaminated aquifer. So the status of the system at time zero, my simulation. Then, because this is the transient, so I need to find the solution at different times, so this is important to know. And I need data for calibration and validation. So for the site, I need all the data I can collect. I need information about the climate, the plumbing, the boundaries, the chemical and hydrological parameters, land use, land cover, geology, geophysics, information I can get from there,
the management of the seedlings. Then I need to know the boundary condition, as I mentioned, the head for flux is at the boundary. And I need to know the initial condition for water and chemical concentrations. And I need all this data for calibration and validation. So I could have geochemical data, I could have water flow path, hydraulic heads, salinities, submarine groundwater discharge, and the chemical concentration. Okay, so here is an example for water. So now I will show how the water in the process system. This is just the application of the things we heard today. So the first step is what?
Conceptual model.
And before you write the conceptual model, you need to see what are your objectives, okay? So we have first to decide what am I interested in, okay? For this example here, we'd like to delineate well protection zones, okay? Basically, if you have a water well, I'd like to delineate the area around the well that should be protected, okay? And there is different criteria for that. The one we will use is the travel time. So I want to set an area around the well that should be protected, which includes 2 or 10 years of travel time. Okay? That means if I have contamination, it can take 2 years in some case, or 10 years, to give you more protection. So you have a smaller area and larger area that need to be delineated. To do that, I need to estimate water levels and velocities, okay? And basically, that will give me 4 directions on the whole island of water. Okay, this is where people can differ now, right? Designing the conceptual model. We agree that we want to do the whole island, okay? Because that's easier. We want to do it for the whole island. And that will be easier to set the boundary conditions, right? Because the boundaries are what? The ocean level, right? The ocean level, which would be first type, right? First type of boundary condition is the water level in the ocean. Because the ocean touches the aquifer, right? So the water level in the aquifer will be the same as the ocean. Should we include tides? No. In a case this, like this, the winds are generally far from the ocean. So we can disagree, but most likely the no tides. Then the processes here is saturated flow and low density. Again, because the winds are far from the ocean, I will not consider density. Some people say, no, this is really serious, because you are protecting the wells from surface contamination. How about salt water, right? If your wells are close to the ocean, then you are having salt water. So really, this is bad assumption for the wells near the ocean. But your defense will be as bad as saying, because it's too complicated to include that. But instead, you know, it is a defense, but not from the ocean. Then the next assumption will assume steady state conditions, which means I will take a time period like 10 years and the average condition of those. Is that acceptable? Maybe, because groundwater is slow, then I can deal with it over periods, right? So 10 years average condition is okay. But if we deal with surface water, it doesn't work, right? Because surface water is too fast and you cannot really take no periods like that. Then for boundaries, the coastline. The boundary condition is specified here at the coastline, as I mentioned, no tides. Then the flow in is aquifer recharge. And the aquifer recharge will be assumed to happen to occur at the water table. Okay? So basically, water will drain, rainwater hits the ground, it takes some time to travel to get to the saturated zone. I will ignore that. Assume recharge. It was whatever goes below the road zone, okay? Whatever passes the road zone will hit the water table immediately. some people will argue about against that, right? Because unsaturated zone in Hawaii is very extensive, so you can't really ignore that. You can't ignore the travel time. And actually, the travel time in the unsaturated zone is good because it is protection, right? So some people say it's a good idea to ignore it because this is additional protection. So I estimated 10 years of travel time, but there is another 10 years in travel in the unsaturated zone. So it is safe, and the safe side to do that. So this is whatever in, going into the aquifer. Then the out will be the well pumping, the springs, and the stream-based flow. Okay, so water can leave the aquifer through wells, springs, or stream-based flow. So I need to know this information and input to someone. So how to get the information? The first step is to collect it from in your office. And one source is this Office of Planning by the State of Hawaii, and there is a link there. It will give you GIS, Geographic Information System data that you can download. There is the extensive data set there if you utilize. And there is this rainfall atlas, which gives you rainfall maps of the islands, as well as evapotranspiration. So you can use that to estimate recharge. So it has maps like these, and you can download it with shapefinders. And here's some of the maps in the GIS coverages. This is the geology of the island of Oahu. Okay. So here is my domain, the boundaries here. And here is all the geology information I have. So now I want to use all this to describe my conceptual, right? I need to know the distribution of aquifer material. So here is, I have basalts, I have deposits, different kind of deposits, etc. We have also this maps, which is relevant for the coverages. I have different aquifer sectors. So this, basically, they use geological information as well as management to design these, protect this aquifer. So here's number one, which is the Honolulu sector, this area here. And it is divided actually into different systems, okay, for management purposes. Number two is the Pearl Harbor aquifer, the most important one on the whole island, which is green color here, and they also divide it to different areas. As, and so forth, like the Waianae, North, Central, and Windrose. So you need to combine this with the regional geological map, because there is some features which are reflected here. Like this is the difference between high elevated water and low elevated water. This is the crest of the mountain, and basically the Ko'olau and Waianae. So basically there's some physical and geological nature that need to be integrated with the previous maps. So if you integrate the two maps based on the boundaries and geological information, you define the hydroconductivity map like this. Okay? So as integrating the two maps together, I decide to include the Schofield area here, the Pearl Harbor area, the Honolulu, etc. So basically, as much as possible, of course, it's not 100% accurate, but that's as detailed as possible. You can see the cut rock here, there's two main formations, or three. So this is basically the boundary of the area between the unconfined and confined area. But basically, you don't need to call it confined because you could have layering. So this would be the top layer, which is a cut rock. Below it is a basalt. So here's the hydroconductivity after calibration. Okay? Remember the calibration process? So that's basically, you start with certain number here and run the model run many times until you get these numbers, which give you a reasonable match. So you could see a wide range of variability, you know, like here is, this is units in feet per day, almost 3,000 feet per day. And here it's like 2,000 feet per day. And you can see this is low conductivity area, you know, because of the dikes between this two formations. So we have to have a range, you know, to tell the model how to estimate. You need a range, so you need to have reasonable estimates before you start.
So is there only dikes cutting horizontally across the island there? That green swath?
Roughly.
I don't know about that. Really?
Something you need to put there to have the high water and scope field,
right.
Otherwise it doesn't calibrate out right.
But you could do it two ways. You could have like individual dikes, which is tedious, right? Because we don't know all the locations, or use some average, because the dikes are separated by basalt. So you could just use some average low conductivity to retard them.
Does it have to be dikes?
Whatever process, because we, good question. We know the head gear is up to 75 meters, okay? And here's the 6 meters, right?
Okay.
We don't really understand the processes that work there. But dikes or, you know, or water cascading like this, we don't know exactly what is it. And that could be a very good area of research. That's what the score would try to do. So basically, we want to create the head difference. And this is also high elevated. Areas, so you have to have the conductivity to the forces. So that's part of the debate, correct? Like the conceptualization.
Mm-hmm.
We want to get this thing to behave, but it can be behave. It can behave using different ways. Okay? So it is more of you know. I think this is the best way to do it, right?
Yeah. But ultimately, you should be able to solve the geologic problem, right?
Say it again?
Ultimately, you want to be able to solve the geologic problem.
Yeah.
Besides the water, you know?
Right, right. But, you know, sometimes it's easier than, you know, some other cases. Subsurface is very complicated, and, you know, it's not seen. So, basically, average condition over certain areas. But actually, Henrietta will tell you, we tried to use the same things like when we do Haiea. The easiest way is to zoom in, you know, take this model and zoom in Haiea and just go, right?
Mm-hmm.
No, because details now is important, right? So you talk about a few miles rather than the scale, the island scale. So things will be different, completely different. We start to zoom again.
Sure.
Then you need recharge, right? As the input to the model, this is what forces water in. And this is the map of recharge, the SGS. They do this water budget models. And you can see it's following rainfall, basically, high recharge in the air and low at the shoreline. But there is agricultural fields, right? So agriculture, irrigation between flows in some areas. So you need a map like this. As input to the model. Then you need the wells. Okay? So we have drinking water wells and the others. We need all the pumping rates for these. Again, averages over the 10-year period of water well in the 80s, this is what we use. And that could be questioned, right? Because pumping rates are changing. But again, depends on your purpose. Average is okay for this case, but if you need to do management for 5 years and under climate change or whatever, you need the time, you know, factor. Then here is the data needed for calibration, okay? we were lucky because there is some numbers all over. So these are the values of Earth. I think these are in feet now, right? So 20 feet here and 275 feet here, 333 here, and 19 feet, 4 feet. So these are the water levels at different locations. This is what I will use for calibration. I will force my model to estimate the head that matches these numbers as much as possible. In some cases, it's not that great, right? In some cases, you know, we don't have enough data to calibrate, which would be difficult to solve. So I will solve that equation. Remember that equation I showed the first one? I will solve that equation to try to match these numbers, and that would be second calibration. But I will create a grid or cells to do the numerical simulation. And here is, you can see a huge number of cells. And the model will solve one equation for each of these cells. And the size is small here when we have many wells. Okay, and it gets larger as you get far from this. This is to try to optimize the shape or the size of your grid by changing the size. If you have activities, more activity, use a smaller size. No, less activity, use larger size. Because the model would be more accurate if you have a small size. But it will be, you know, too difficult to run if you have too many. And this is the cross section. Any observations here? What seems funny about this? The top is the mountain, right? That's okay. So this is the ground elevation, this cross section. The Schofield is here. Okay, what do you note about the bottom of the aquifer?
Too shallow.
Here? Yeah, how did we decide when it's here? We probably did that for the model, right? Mm-hmm. How did we decide the bottom?
Right.
So basically, because we don't kill anyone now, we ignore density, right? So we don't have salt water here. So we need only fresh water. So we need the bottom of the aquifer, right? We have to have a bottom. So the bottom is assumed to be the salt water, fresh water interface. Okay? And we use the Gibbon-Herzberg formula, which is 1 to 40. So for every 1 foot above the mean sea level, we have 40 feet below, okay? So that will give me a lens if of ideal situation with 1 at the top fresh and 40 fresh below. So we use the bottom as a boundary. That's assuming that salt water will not be active at all. So fresh water will move and not mix with salt water, okay? And that could be serious limitation, because we know there is interaction with this. But for that purpose, for my objective, that's okay, right? But you notice here, this is 41 also, so get to a high level here. By the way, this is 2 layers, okay? So the bottom one is this one. This is also 41, and this is the start of the Schofield area, right? Because it's much thicker here. But we chop it down at, I think, 2 kilometers or 2.5 kilometers. Why?
Because
right, because we assume conductivity will be too low because of the overburden, and there's no flow below that. That's assumption. And I think Don Thomas found something, like a kilometer or something.
There's water deep down, and it's like hyper-saline water, there's fresh water.
So would that be still a good idea or not?
Well, I mean, you have to make whatever assumptions you have to make for your model to work, and
right.
No point in assuming random things if you don't really understand.
Right. Actually, this is sometimes a trouble with models because you still get reasonable answer, even with the wrong assumption, you know, sometimes. As I mentioned, the models can work. But still, to some extent, you know, you have very low conductivity and low porosity, you know, because of the overburden, so it's okay. But if we do the density model, we don't have to do that, right? Because we can include salt water in this. Then here is the calibration results. So we run the model many times manually and using automatic calibration. Then we stopped when we thought we have good accuracy. The good accuracy meaning what we estimated by the model compared to the observed values fits around the 45 degrees line. If you have perfect match, then everything falls in the line, but that's not possible, of course. So you have lots of scatter here, some errors, but that's considered reasonable. So this is for the basal values, which is less than 25 or 30 feet. For high elevated, which is, oh no, this is a different distant basal. Okay. And we have other curve for high elevated range. That's coming. So that's basically for the high elevated number. And you could also do some statistical error estimates. So what do we have here? The final results. Okay, the final results. So you can see here the water elevations. Again, this is meters, sorry about mixing units. So here is the Bear Harbor area. You can see the school field. You can see the different elevations. This is non-conformity between Waianae and Kolau. And it looks reasonable, right? So all of these low elevated water and high elevated area. And you can actually plot the error bars for all of the lines, all the observation points. But that's what you are convinced that there is reasonable estimation of the hydraulic head for that simulated time. Okay? That's the idea. So we create the conceptual model, solve the equations, calibrate using a certain model, calibrate until we are convinced that the model is accurate. What would be the next step?
Application.
And that's basically the remember the delineation thing. So we run another model that works with this one, and that gives me the protection areas. So basically the blue areas here are the 2 year travel time. And the red will include the blue as well. That would be the 10 year travel time. So if you have a chemical here, okay, then it, at the edge it will get to 10 years to get here. Okay? So that would be like enough time to do something about it. Okay? That's fine. Or you can restrict land use in these areas. And this island of Maui, they do that. Now they started using our results to make decisions. Like say if you want to build a gas station in this area, they would say no, right? It doesn't make sense to do it close to the water. Or maybe cemetery or things. So that's example application, right? So the steps are what I mentioned, right? Create a model, calibrate it, then run it to get some results. Okay, any questions here? Does this explain your concern?
Yeah, okay.
Any questions? Another example, maybe we make it here. Oh, before I go to the next example, now that solution for was for the whole island. But sometimes you are not interested in the whole island, you're interested in the Pearl Harbor aquifer. Then you need now to set the boundaries. Okay? So I know the boundaries are here, and I need to set the conditions. So this one will be no flow. No flow is a special case of the flux, right? The flux boundary having to be known as zero. Flux is zero, right? So it is station here. There's no flow here, and no flow here. They made this, this five flux because we know there is some water exchange between the harbor and the middle. But here, if you are interested in SCGD or density, you have to extend the boundary outside. So you have to go outside, here is the ocean, and specify the condition at the ocean here for this area. So your modeling area is that whole area here, and we need to set the boundary condition. And you solve the equations within this area. So another example is Jeju Island in Korea. So we did this project right to assess sustainability, water sustainability under climate and land use changes. So the island of Jeju is like similar to Oahu. There's a tourist attraction, they call it Honeymoon Island. Korean goes there for honeymoon. It has lots of tourists, visitors. It is, all the resources basically comes from the ground, like Oahu. They want to expand the water use. The water is good, they want to sell it as bottled water. So they want to make sure that the sources are sustainable. You know, if there's climate change or land change. So we use criteria to see if water level will decline under these changes. We want to see if what happened to the springs. We have near shoreline springs. It is very important to them from a cultural point of view. And we want to see if salinity will increase in parts of the island.
Yeah, Ali, I didn't ask how many slides you had. You guys want to take a break for a few minutes? Because it's 4 o'clock now. We've been sitting here for an hour and a half. Can I take a 5-minute break or something? Maybe?
Okay.
Unless you got like 2 slides left.
No, stay.